Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. We welcome you to join Glen Baptist Church Worship Service this morning. Indeed, it is good to meet with you all, even though you are at your various homes. Bless you. Let us prepare our hearts as we come to the Lord this morning with our praises and worship, prayers, reading of His Word, and the preaching of His Word. May we be encouraged and ministered to by God, His Word, and His Spirit. Let us pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for you are our God, Father, who loves us, care for us, provide for us, and protect us. Thank you for your presence and your guidance during these difficult times of the COVID-19 pandemic. Lord, as we meet with you and with one another through this online platform, Lord, we pray that may we be encouraged by your word, O Lord. And as we come to sing to you through songs of praise and worship, indeed may the words minister to us too. And may our songs, our worship rise to you as an aroma pleasing unto you. Indeed, Lord, accept our praise and worship and sacrifices of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you for Jesus, your only Son, whom you sent to die for us on the cross, so that our relationship with you can be restored and renewed, O Lord. Thank you, Father. Bless you, O Lord. We give all praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Indeed, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, we give you praise. Worthy is the Lord, for he reigned throughout eternity. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Sing that again.
Holy.
Sing praise.
Oh, sovereign God, oh, matchless King, the saints adore, the angels sing, and fall before the throne of grace. To you belongs the highest praise. These sufferings, this passing time, under your wings I will abide, and every enemy shall flee. You are my hope and victory. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit.
Comforter, keeper, Spirit, we long. Good morning, brothers and friends of KBC. Welcome to our service this morning. And here are this week's announcement. First, this coming Friday is our online corporate prayer meeting. Let me encourage you, all of you, to come and join this online corporate prayer meeting because it's very important for us to pray together as a church. Next, on-site Sunday service will be suspended until further notice due to MCO in Klang. As a result of that, we will not be observing the Holy Communion until we resume our on-site Sunday service. Meanwhile, let me encourage you to invite a few friends or brothers and sisters to watch the service together, especially those of you who are not in Klang. And this is one way for us to maintain our corporate fellowship together. Next, Encounter with Jesus book study. As part of a learning and growing together, we will be having a study and discussion on the books Encounter with Jesus by Tim Keller. We'll be discussing chapter 4 this afternoon. And this study is open to everyone on Zoom without any sign up. Please feel free to join and we'll send a Zoom link to you after service today. Finally, let me encourage you to sign up for this Gospel-Centered Self-Care Seminar. This seminar will help us to see how the gospel can address our anxiety, fear, and stresses during this pandemic season. And the speaker is Louise Calabrine. She is the Director of Counseling and Leadership Development at Redeemer City to City. She has taught numerous workshops on gospel transformation globally and has involved in equipping pastors and leaders with biblical training and gospel-centered counseling. And this seminar will be conducted through watching through pre-recorded message by Louis and facilitated by me. It's scheduled on Saturday, October 31st from 1:30 to 4:30. And this seminar will be held at church but could change to Zoom depending on the COVID situation in Klang. If you are interested, please register with me. Thank you.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. This morning's scripture reading is taken from Acts chapter 17, verses 1 to 34. When Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. "This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah," he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now, the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens, and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, and also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. Here ends the reading of God's word. God bless you.
Almighty God, we come this day to pray along with David the psalmist. We hear the words of Psalm 36. Sin whispers to the wicked deep within their hearts. They have no fear of God at all. In their blind conceit, they cannot see how wicked they really are. Everything they say is crooked and deceitful. They refuse to act wisely or do good. They lie awake at night, hatching sinful plots. Their actions are never good. They make no attempt to turn from evil. But your unfailing love, O Lord, is vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice like the ocean depths. You care for people and animals alike, O Lord. How precious is your unfailing love, O God. All humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. You feed them from the abundance of your own house, letting them drink from your river of delights. For you are the fountain of life, the light by which we see. Pour out your unfailing love on those who love you. Give justice to those with honest hearts. Lord, our sins are many. It is easy to look into our own thoughts, our own deeds, at our hands, and even our hearts, to find that there is indeed nothing good in us apart from you. We are born spiritually dead in our sins, as sons of disobedience, as children of wrath, deserving of nothing but your hand of justice. How can we not despair? But in your unfailing love, you sent your Son, Jesus, to give his life for us. Your gospel tells us that we are so radically lost, but it also tells us that we are loved and so radically saved through our Lord Jesus Christ. So with Paul we can say, "I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me." Let this be our motivation, our joy, and our hope in our Christian walk. We pray for our world and the pandemic. Let us first recognize that this is not a season for sentimental views of God. It is a bitter season, and you ordained it. You govern it. You will end it in your own time. No part of it is outside of your sway. Life and death are in your hand. Sovereign God, this outbreak is a physical picture of the moral and spiritual ugliness of sin and rejecting you. The coronavirus is your call for all of us to repent and realign our lives with the infinite worth and beauty of Christ. So we pray, open the eyes of our hearts to see and savor the beauty of Christ. Incline our hearts to your word, your Son, and your way. Fill us with compassionate courage and make a name for yourself in the way your people serve. Let us put aside self-pity and fear. Let us lean towards the need of others, not our own comfort, and move towards love for others, not safety for ourselves. We look to you, O God. We pray for our country. Let your love surround our leaders. Give wisdom and guidance to them, that they may lead this country and her people in this difficult time. While we seek for justice and good in this land, let your church, the church in Malaysia, be your voice in this nation. Let us set the example in truth, grace, and unity. We need your mercy, O God, to be effective witness in this culture. For apart from you, we can do nothing on our own. Remember also those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for those who are stricken by terrible diseases and illnesses. We pray for your healing grace upon them. May your comfort and strength be with them, and your presence be the anchor of their soul in this time. We look to you, O God. We pray you bless your servant, Pastor Gideon, this morning. Let him preach your truth with clarity so that we may receive your word with joy and gladness. We pray also for the work of the Holy Spirit among us, that we may receive the word and be able to apply your truth to our lives and live as your faithful disciples. Loving Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Paul was concerned about the city of Athens. You know, maybe like my mom gets concerned when my room gets trash, maybe something like that. Paul was concerned because Athens was full of false idols that the people had made. It made Paul sad to see people worshiping false gods. Paul went to the synagogue and talked with the Jews about Jesus. Every day in the marketplace, he would tell the good news about Jesus and the resurrection to anyone who was there. Some philosophers, you don't know what a philosopher is? A philosopher were usually men who like to think and reason and argue a lot. Anyway, some philosophers heard Paul teach. "What is this babbler trying to say?" they asked one another. "He seems to be preaching about foreign gods." Other men wanted to hear more, so they invited Paul to speak at the Areopagus, a place where people came to discuss important ideas. The men said, "What you say sounds strange to us. We want to know what it means." Paul spoke respectfully. "People of Athens," he began, "I see you are very religious people. I even saw an altar you have for an unknown god. I can tell you about it. The God who made the world is Lord of heaven and earth. He does not live in places people make. He does not need anything from us, because he is the one who gives life and everything else. He created the people of every nation and wants them to know him as God. We live and move and exist through him. We are his, and he is not made of gold or silver or stone like man makes." Paul continued, "God is alive, and he commands all people everywhere to repent and turn away from disobeying him." Paul also explained that God sent Jesus. When Paul told how Jesus rose from the dead, some people made fun of Paul. Others wanted to hear more. Because of Paul taught the good news of Jesus, some men and women in Athens became followers of Jesus.
Greetings to you in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters and friends of KBC. Before I begin my sermon, let's pray. Father, as we come before you, we want to thank you for your scripture. Help us to read and mark and learn and digest it so that our life can be transformed by your words. Lead us and guide us as we listen to your words. In Jesus' name, amen. Prior to his ascension, Jesus entrusted the Great Commission to his disciples, and he said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." And again in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, Jesus told his disciples to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. To be his witnesses to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. The disciple of Jesus had to bring the gospel to people where they were. And this pattern repeated itself throughout the book of Acts under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, through his prompting and circumstances, Jesus' follower intentionally took the gospel to all nations. The church of Antioch was a prime example. It set Paul and Barnabas apart for them to take the gospel to the Gentiles. In Paul's first missionary journey, he and Barnabas took the gospel to the provinces of West Asia. And then in his second missionary journey, because of the Macedonian call, he and Silas took the gospel to Europe. Last week, we saw how Paul and his team spread the gospel there and established a church in Philippi, the major European city at the time. Today, we will continue to look at Paul's second missionary journey trip in three more European cities, which was recorded for us in Acts chapter 17, verse 1 to 34. And if you have a Bible, please turn to Acts chapter 17. From Paul and his team ministry in these three cities, we can learn how to bring the gospel to where people are. We last saw Paul in Philippi. After saying goodbye to the new church that he had just founded, he, Silas, and Timothy traveled to Thessalonica. And Luke told us in Acts chapter 17, verse 1, when Paul and his companion has passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. A long journey of 100 miles, the trip took Paul and his team at least 3 days to get to Thessalonica. Paul intentionally chose to go there because it was such an influential city, and he knew if he could plant a church there, the entire region could be touched by the gospel. Travelers from Rome to Asia had to pass through Thessalonica. Unlike Philippi, Thessalonica had a synagogue. Once Paul and his team arrived, they went straight to the synagogue. Verse 2 and 3 say, as was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scripture, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. This Jesus I'm proclaiming to you is the Messiah, he said. Paul began by initiating a study of scriptures with any and all who will listen to him. Luke says he reasoned with them from the scripture. The Greek word translated reason is a root for our English word dialogue. Scripture expounded, question asked, answer given. He dialogued with them from the scripture. Further, he explained and gave evidence that the Christ, Messiah, had to suffer and rise again. At this point, he wasn't saying anything about Jesus. He just simply showed them from the Old Testament scripture how the Messiah had to suffer and die. That was the major problem the Jews had with Jesus for being Messiah. They have no concept of a suffering Messiah. So Paul had to show them how the scripture point to this, much as Jesus had done for the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. It was there all along, but they had missed it. He would have taken them to passages like Isaiah 53 and Psalm 22. Once he had done that, the next step was to show how Jesus the Nazarene had perfectly fulfilled these scriptures. Paul exhibited great patience and care, taking time to show them Jesus from the Old Testament scripture. Luke stressed that Paul was in synagogue for three Sabbaths. Most likely he did it for three consecutive Sabbaths, although he probably ministered in the area much longer than that. This was not a one-shot approach. Luke continued to told us about the response. Look at verse 4. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. A few Jews believe, however, a large number of Greeks, the God-seeking Greeks who had come to the synagogue hoping to hear the truth about the living God, believed after hearing the gospel. Among them, a group of the city's leading women also came. It seemed the gospel had a particular appeal to women, especially those in the upper class. Educated women who were instructed in Greek philosophies have found these ideas to be empty, offering nothing to meet their deepest need. In addition, Greek beliefs and society regraded women and left them feeling disrespected and undervalued. Many had turned to Judaism for answer, but have found only duty with burdensome regulations, which again left them empty. Then Paul came with the good news that all were created equal before God, but had sinned against God's, and therefore all deserve God's judgment and punishment. Yet God, in His grace, sent Jesus Christ to die for all, and all who believe in Him were adopted into God's family. And so in Christ, there was neither male nor female, slave nor free, Gentile or Jews, nor any distinction. All man-made distinctions were broken down, and they have heard how Jesus had treated women with respect and dignity. And this woman responded and said, "Yes, that's what I want. That's what I've been looking for." As mentioned before, the gospel always creates mixed reactions. Some of the Jews rejected Paul and his message. Luke told us in verses 5-9 that they were inflamed with misplaced zeal, went to town to recruit some gangster. Luke described them as wicked men. They were troublemakers, so they came with the Jews to the house of Jason, Paul's host. They sought to bring Paul and Silas out. Fortunately, Jason had already sent them elsewhere. So they dragged Jason and some of the other brothers before the city officials, accusing them first of causing trouble all over the world. Another translation put it, turning the world upside down. That turn of phrase is certainly descriptive but funny. They had it backward, you see. Their world had been upside down ever since sin took hold of humanity through Adam. But when you turn something over that's already upside down, you turn it right side up. That's what the gospel does. It allows us to live right side up in an upside down world. Then they accused Paul and the others of proclaiming Jesus as another king. There was some truth in there. I'm sure Paul had taught the disciples that their ultimate allegiance was to King Jesus, who will one day return to set up his kingdom. That's always part of the message of the good news. Like Herod, Caesar and his followers will be threatened by such a message. But it seemed that the city officials didn't take that accusation seriously. They simply asked Jason to post a bond and then released them. Paul and Silas then moved to Berea. Berea was 60 miles from Thessalonica. Look what happened in Berea. Verse 10 to 11 said, as soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica. Again, Paul entered the synagogue and no doubt began with the same methods as before, reasoning from scriptures, explaining and showing that Jesus was the Messiah. However, Luke intentionally drew a sharp contrast. He called these Bereans more noble-minded. The idea behind Luke's word choice was to be willing to learn and to evaluate ideas fairly because they examined scripture carefully. It meant to have open mind. With their spirit of openness and eagerness to learn, they received the word. They thirst for a deeper understanding of God's word. So Luke says they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scripture every day to see if what Paul said was true. They had open minds, but they didn't have empty heads. Their openness was mixed with a healthy caution and discernment. They didn't just take Paul's word for everything. They check it out for themselves. That's what it meant to be noble-minded. But now the outcome was predictable. Luke said many believed. They found the things Paul said were true. They checked it out on the scriptures. So many believed, including a large number of prominent Greek women and men believed. But just as predictable as the gospel being received by many, opposition was also close at hand. Look at verse 15. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God in Berea, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. It wasn't enough to drive Paul out of their own town. These angry, jealous Jews from Thessalonica traveled all the way 60 miles to Berea and employed the same tactic to disrupt Paul's ministry there. Again, Paul had to slip out of the city after nightfall. He then traveled 200 miles to Athens, leaving Silas and Timothy behind to establish and encourage the church in Berea. Paul arrived alone in Athens. Though it had been some 400 years since the Golden Age of Greece, Athens was still the intellectual center of the world. It was a center of philosophical learning led by Socrates and Plato. It was an age of art. Praxiteles developed the classical form of human sculpture, which later imitated by Michelangelo. By the time Paul arrived, Athens was a shadow of its former glory, but it was still a center of intellectual excellence and an impressive sight. Verse 16 tells us what he saw. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. What caught Paul's attention was not the impressive architecture or history of the city, but the idols of the city. Luke expressed the idea with the word full of idols. Pausanias, a Greek geographer who visited Athens 50 years later, said it was easier to meet a god or a goddess on the street of Athens than to meet a man. Athens at the time was filled with temples, shrines, and altars. Paul's spirit was greatly distressed when he saw all these idols. Every idol demonstrated the Athenians' hunger for God, but it also testified to their spiritual darkness. Ignorant of the true God, the Athenians were lost, and Paul felt a desperate concern for the spiritual need before his very eyes. As believers, do our heart trouble by what we see, by the concern of God? Especially the concern of God is for the people to come to know them, but yet people were blinded by the things of this world, especially the idols. And there are many people just denying the one true God and giving the allegiance to false God. Ken Hughes said, if we experience no inner paroxysm, which means no inner move, you know, conversion or birth, we either have not truly been redeemed by Jesus Christ or we have become apathetic to the things of God. This is a very strong statement. Are you concerned with those who are spiritually lost? If not, why? Perhaps you may need to examine your faith in Christ. Paul could not be indifferent or detached. He jumped right in and brought the gospel message to Athens. You know, verse 17 to 21 said, so he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Paul began to dialogue with anyone who would talk to him, and he found three groups who listened. The first was the Jews and God-fearing Gentiles in the synagogue, and he reasoned with them, showing them from Scripture Jesus was the Messiah. Second, he visited the marketplace and shared with people who were just passing by. And this is like engaging in a conversation today with people at a mall or park or your favorite kopitiam or like cafe. And he did this not just on the Sabbath, but every day. He was mixing it up with anyone he who he could entice into a conversation. And third, he shared with a group of philosophers, the Epicureans and the Stoics. The Epicureans were basically atheists. At least they believed the gods to be so far removed, that they didn't have any involvement with our world. They believed that everything happened by chance and death was the end, extinction without afterlife. This life, especially the present, was the only thing that really exists, and life should be lived to get the most out of it. Pleasure was the highest virtue for this group. Their motto was, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. They live for a moment, and we call it materialism today, and many people still follow this path. The Stoics, on the other hand, were pantheists. They believed everything was God. God was in a rock or trees and everywhere, and they were also fatalists. Whatever happened to them was their destiny, just accept it. Their motto was grind and bear it. Consequently, they sought to live with apathy and detachment. There are certainly still people following this path today, and these people worship God in all things, and they feel that the best thing they can do is to take whatever come, handle it the best they can, and be proud of that. Notice the direction of the audience after hearing Paul. Some of them call him an idle babbler. The word babbler literally meant sick pecker. They saw Paul as a little bird in the marketplace going around pecking at sticks here and there. They thought of him as a mere collector of fragments of truth, gathering a few choice words from philosophers that he had picked up along the way and was trying to impress people. And they smiled and dismissed his message. Others were intrigued by his message on Jesus and his resurrection, thinking he was trying to introduce a new God to them. Luke suggests these people love to hang out and talk about the latest idea. They are like some of folks in Kopitiam, you know, they love to talk all kinds of stuff, the latest trend, all kinds of subject, the latest development on the politics. You know, this group of people want to hear more, so they invite Paul to speak to them at the Areopagus, which translated man, Mahius. It used to be a place where the highest judicial court of Greeks met. By Paul's time, it had become more like a council of men who kept watch over the city's religious and moral belief. So, what did Paul proclaim in Areopagus? Verse 22 to 23 said, Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walk around and look carefully at the objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. What an introduction. He began at a starting point where his audience could understand. He didn't denounce them or attack them or, you know, make fun of them, put them down, saying, how could you be so dense? Oh, come on, how could you believe in a wood, worship wood or stone? He didn't do any of that. Paul was unquestionably eager to point them to the truth, but he restrained himself and gave them a genuine compliment. He met them where they were. And then he continued, as I look around your famous city, I found an altar to an unknown God. And let me tell you the truth about the one you are worshipping. And Paul established common ground with them. Paul's message makes a brilliant application, and he pointed out their problem. The word translated unknown means without knowledge. The Athenians were supposed to know everything, but they had missed the most important truth. They didn't know the one true living God. Many of them probably grasped the apostles' agony. Having established the contact point, Paul now began to tell them about this one true living God. According to Tim Keller, Paul outlined six things about God in his message to the Athenians, which helped to address some of the misconceptions these people would have had. First, Paul told them God was the creator of all things. Verse 24, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. Paul began by explaining God wasn't created by man. He is the one who makes man and everything else that exists in all the universe. And that's why we have purpose and value, because we were created by him. As the Lord of heaven and earth, he can't be confined by a man-made temple. This was a very different from the finite gods of the Greek, many of whom were created or created themselves, and from all the pervasive gods of Eastern religions who are identical with the life force of all things. Rather, this God has existed before the world, and he brought everything and everyone into being. Next, Paul told them God was the sustainer of life. As the giver and a sustainer of life, God wasn't looking for anything from man. Again, this contrasts with the Greek gods who had to be constantly appeased with gifts or they would be angry. And this true God was the giver and sustainer of life. He gave life and breath for all things. If he withdrew his sustaining hand, all would disintegrate. And the truth was clear. God could not be domesticated as an idol. He couldn't be placated or manipulated because he needed nothing. Next, Paul told them God was the Lord of history. Look at verse 26. He marked out their appointed time in history and the boundaries of their land. Paul communicated this true God was also very involved with us, for in him we live and move and have our being. True God, though God was above all and transcendent, Paul continued, he was not far from us. He was behind all the circumstances of history. He was very near and involved with us. Next, Paul told them God made us for fellowship with him. Verse 27 says, God did this so that they would seek him and find him. This was an amazing statement. Paul was saying that God desires to have a relationship with his creations, that this God created us in his image to be like him, a relational being, so that we can be in relationship with him. This was not all at all like the Greek gods who only wanted loyalty, not loving communion. This was not like the Eastern pantheistic gods who could only be sensed or experienced but without any relational quality. Paul stressed his point. God was personal yet powerful. And this point also implied a very high view of human beings, because not only we are created, God desired to have relationship with us, the most high God, the God of the universe, the most highest being in this entire universe, desired to have a relationship with us, and he speak value in a great high view of human beings. Fifth, God can't be worshipped as an idol, an image. And now Paul drew his first implication from a previous point. If God was all-powerful, then he shaped human beings and they must worship him as he wants it to be done. Human cannot shape him and worship as they want it to be done, because they are his creation. They are the offspring created by him. How is it then so many people try to create their own religion? We must remember that modern people follow very much the same tradition as those who make their own status to worship. Today, it is common to hear people say, you know, I like to think God as such and such. And or someone will say, you know, everyone has to determine what God is for him or herself. If not, I wouldn't believe that is idolatry. Of what value will a God be who follows your self-appointed rules? It would be a very finite God conformed to only your image. If that's the case, the reality is that you are your own God. All these idols are just your delivery system. They are servant. They are serving you. You're using them to set up your own private kingdom. 6. God makes Jesus the judge of the world. Paul explained that God has been patient to overlook ignorance in the past, but a day of reckoning is coming when he will judge the world. Judgment is inevitable. Paul even told them who the judge will be. Here, finally, he, at the end of his message, Paul brought in Christ. He emphasized the resurrection, proof that Christ would return to judge the world. For this reason, he called them to repent, turning from their idols to the one true living God. Paul's message to the Athenians crowd was brilliant. He began with the doctrine of God, helping them to understand who God was first, and then only introduced Christ to them. As his audience heard about the resurrection, some laughed in contempt and others wanted to learn more about it later. It seems that his speech ended abruptly, not giving him any more time to talk more about Jesus, about what Christ has done for them. Nevertheless, his message confronted both the Epicureans and the Stoic views. The Epicureans saw God as personal, but removed and uninvolved with human affairs. They were happy Hedonists, teaching that life consisted of following your desires. The Stoics, on the other hand, saw God as a kind of life force controlling everything, but not a personal being to know or obey. They were pessimists, teaching that life consists of following your duty. To the Epicureans, Paul said, God is near and he's your judge. You cannot just do anything you like, you want. To the Stoic, Paul said that God is personal and savior. You can know hope and have freedom. He was telling the Epicureans not to make either an idol of pleasure. And he was telling the Stoic not to make an idol of duty. Paul was trying to help them to see that their worth was not found in doing whatever they desire, nor built upon their good works duty, but was found in Christ. There are many concepts we can take to heart from Paul's ministry in these three cities. Let's look at them. To bring the gospel to where people are, we first must know the gospel. To share the gospel, we must know the gospel. What is the gospel? Simply put, it's news about what God has done for us through Christ to save us. It's news about what has been done by Jesus to put right our relationship with God. In other religions, their gods reveal instruction how an individual can find or achieve salvation. They are told to follow instruction. Therefore, their salvation is dependent on them, how good they are following the instruction. In Christianity, God achieves salvation for us. The gospel brings news primarily about what Christ has done for us rather than instruction. So we need to know this news so that we can help people to see the difference. Also, we are not only saved by the gospel, but we are also grow by applying the gospel to every area of our lives. As Peter said, we need to continue to grow in our grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ so that we may testify the power of the gospel in changing our lives. And to do that, we must be like the Bereans, studying God's word religiously and applying them into our lives. In doing so, we can present, explain, and prove the truth of the gospel as we relate it to others. Can you say, The Christian life can be more stimulating if we allow ourselves to be open to learning and growth, continuing immersing ourselves in the scriptures. God's word will keep us in touch with the fundamental issues of life and so keep us alive and growing to be the honorable ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Whenever Paul arrives in the new city, he either goes to the synagogue or the marketplace to share the gospel. You see, to bring the gospel to where people are, we need to meet with people where they are. This is what Paul did. He would consistently go to the same place for a period of time. Just as Luke mentioned, he was at the Thessalonica synagogue for 3 consecutive Sabbaths. When I was working as a research associate in the LSU Medical Center in Shreveport, I would intentionally hang out and eat lunch with a Chinese scholar or student there. Even after I no longer worked there but became the pastor of a Chinese church, I would still go there once a week to eat lunch with the group. Like Paul, my purpose was to connect with them, listen to them, and look for opportunity to engage in gospel conversation with them. And here in Malaysia, for various reasons, I didn't do this as much as I should, but from time to time, I intentionally go eat at my neighborhood's kopitiam cafe by myself and hang out with the folks there. And this message reminds me I need to do more of that. Do this more. So let me encourage you to be intentionally to go hang out with your friends at your favorite kopitiam or mama. You know, hang out with your colleagues. I know during this MCO, some of us who are under MCO, this is difficult, but let me encourage you to find a way to do that. Hang out with your colleagues, classmates, students, customer, or your sport khaki, those who you play games with, you know, regularly meet up with them, eat lunch with them, engaging with them, listening to them, and then looking for an opportunity to open up a spiritual conversation. And as you engage in conversation with them, with your unbelieving friends, look for a point of contact to engage in spiritual conversation. When Paul was with the Jews, his point of contact was the Messiah. Whereas when he was with the Athenians, his point of contact was their idols, especially the one unknown God. And one way to find a point of contact is to ask people what do they believe and how they worship and why they worship that way or why they believe what they believe. Generally, this opens the doors for you to share your faith as well. After hearing from them, you can thank them and then take the opportunity to share your faith with them. You know, as you're doing this, pray and ask God to help you to listen attentively and be sensitive to the prompting of spirit and know when to build a bridge and bring in the spiritual conversation with your unbelieving friends. And in your dialogue with them, you know, and especially with your dialogue with people about faith, you know, affirm their faith, especially if they share that with you, affirm their faith first and then challenge about their faith later, just as Paul did with the Athenians at the Areopagus. He began his conversation with sincere compliment, and then you know, he said, I see that you are very religious. Then he very subtly appealed to Athenians' admission of ignorance about the divine, the unknown God author. And Paul saw that author as their acknowledgement of the limitation of their religion. And the reason they made such an order was because they had a deep sense that they were missing something in their religion, that they had not really broken through to God. Paul pinpointed this omission by saying, hey, look, the God that you haven't been able to discover, he is the one I will reveal to you today. In my conversation with people who believe in doing good works to make up for their passing, I usually will affirm them first, affirm their desire to do good, and then I'll challenge them to think more deeply about this teaching, by saying that if this teaching was true, is true, then there will be no true inward transformation in us. Because I, for one, will be doing bad things on one hand, but with confidence that I can always make it up with my good works. As a result, there's no real change, no transformation in my life. As you're doing this, always remember, make sure you treat your friends with respect and dignity, not with a condescending attitude. Paul respected his audience no matter where they started from their quest for God. He didn't demand that they swallow what he said simply because he said, in sharing our faith, we must give others room to move and think. We must respect, you know, their feedback to us. They say if they need more time, or you know, they just say, oh, I have enough, it's all right. Then we stop there. Now, should they show interest in the Christian faith after your dialogue with them, invite them to explore further with you during Bible study or Christianity Explore. You know, invite them to do this with you. In Thessalonica, Paul did an intensive Bible study with the people there for 3 consecutive Sabbaths, showing the people Jesus was the fulfillment of the Old Testament scripture. In Berea, he led the people there to carefully examine the scripture for a period of time. As a result, many believe. The advantage of doing Bible study or Christianity Explore with seekers over a period of time is very significant. Time will allow for explanations, questions, and answers. Time will help them to have better understanding of the gospel. You see, as the study progresses over time, you can address their personal concerns or any barriers they may have in regard to the gospel. And this is why those who have gone through a period of consistent study responded to the gospel more favorably. As you do this, you yourself, you grow in your relationship, in your grace, in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ as well. So my brother and sister, let me encourage you to be intentional. Know the gospel and go and share the gospel. Take the gospel with you to where people are and look for opportunity to engage with them. Paul's example of meeting his audience at where they are, at their own starting point, certainly echoes the example of Christ himself. The incarnation of Jesus is just that, meeting humankind at our starting point. We couldn't reach God, so he came to us, Emmanuel. God with us. We too have been recipients of God's grace in meeting us where we were. As I look back my spiritual journey, you know, I can see God has sent many people into my life in a timely manner, meeting where I am, helping me to know the gospel, understand the gospel, and grow in the gospel, grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, we have become his disciple. We have accepted him. Jesus wants us to go and meet people at where they are, so others, they too can come to know Jesus and be his disciple and enjoy the eternal life with him. And he promised to be with us as we go. Remember, we are not doing this alone. He is with us, working with us, working through us, and guiding us. So my dear brother and sister, let's continue to do this. Let's respond to the call of God. Be his witnesses at where we are, bringing the gospel to people, you know, to share Christ's love for them. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, may our hearts burn with sacred truth. Flames of the Holy Spirit that cannot remain within us but burst but must overflow to others, drawing them into personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. May we grieve with you over the idolatry all around us and move to speak and leave the gospel so that others will come into your precious kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's pause for a couple minutes and reflect what you have just heard, and then I'll come back with the benedictions. Let's receive the benedictions. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the loving kindness of our Heavenly Father, the presence and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, empower you to bring the gospel to the people God placed around you. In Jesus' name, amen. Go and serve the Lord. Be His witness wherever He leads you.